Hey, welcome to FixedByDoc, and while we cruise down our main road back to our RV park on our way home, I thought I'd give you a quick commentary on where we are with our land buying. So, we are in Pennsylvania, and we've been working on purchasing 5 acres of land in a specific township around here. It's off in a farming district, if you want to call it that, about 20 minutes outside of the nearest city or town, if you can call it that. Katanning isn't, to my standards, isn't actually big enough to be called a city, but they call it a city here.
It's big, you goober.
So, but anyways, it's in an area where we want. It's close enough to town to go in and out, get what we need and supplies and stuff without being a hassle, but it's far enough out of town in the rural district to be away from all the commotion and all that mess. So if shit hits the fan or anything like that, we're out in the middle, basically out in the middle of nowhere, where it won't really affect us too bad. And so the land that we're getting is 5 acres for just over $10,000. The land is $1,200 down payment, $400 a month for 2 years. And then we went and talked to the waste management department about how we're, or sewage enforcement agency.
Yeah.
Either one is basically the same thing. And they have given approval for our composting toilet because it's a self-contained system. Our composting toilet is set to do 4 people full-time with an additional 2 people part-time, or it could do 6 people full-time with the addition of a solar fan installed in the venting pipe, which we intend to put a solar fan in the venting pipe anyhow. So, but there's only 2 of us using it, and because it's self-contained and capable of doing 6 people with only 2 people using it, you know, there's no way we're gonna overflow it, and we have multiple bins for it as well. So they approved that for all of our black water or black waste. It's basically considered a dry composting. So that's been approved, so we do not have to put in a septic tank or anything like that. Which means no permits, no restrictions, no perk tests or anything. So that's a couple $1,000s there that we are saving. The septic tank, Evix Evilanius was telling me it's around $30,000 to put a septic tank in California.
I do
not know what it cost out here in Pennsylvania. I don't know what it costs, but out in California, it's around $30,000.
We don't
have to do any of that. So with the composting toilet, there's no smell, there's no nothing to worry about. It's a very eco-friendly. It's a waterless toilet. It's dry composting. So there's nothing to worry about, and you can take the compost, mix it in with your soil for your gardening, for your trees and bushes and stuff like that, and have no worries. So for our gray water, the only thing they wanted us to do is show what we were doing with our gray water. And for our gray water, we are purchasing a 300 gallon tank, storage tank, that has a fill valve on the top and a release valve on the bottom. So our gray water will flow into a 300 gallon storage tank, and then that storage tank will have a hose hookup on the bottom that will flow into a what's called an evaporative pool. The evaporative pool will be filled with loose sandy like soil, and in that soil will be, we will plant marsh plants, stuff like cattails and some other kind of marsh plants, stuff that sucks up the water and helps it to evaporate really fast. And then, if need be, we'll have another solar fan that blows the air across the evaporative pool to help evaporate the gray water. And we will put a carport-style roof over it to prevent any rain from overflowing our pool. So if when it rains, the rainwater won't get into our pool. Only our gray water will be able to get into the pool. And in that way, the greenhouse effect will also help heat it up and evaporate it off. And it's only gray water, which means it's only water from our shower and our sink. So there's no smell in that. And the only smell that would come from that would be off of whatever soap we use for our washing our dishes and while washing our bodies. So the cattails, I know, absorb all those kind of toxins and stuff. They're really good for absorbing arsenic and all that kind of whatnot.
Hopefully we won't have arsenic in our soap though. But we'll get a different soap.
So because the gray water will never touch the ground,
that was the key.
Then we don't have any permits or restrictions on it. And so we won't have any problems with that. As far as our freshwater tank, we will have another 300-gallon tank that our spring will fill the 300-gallon tank, and then we will pump water out of the 300-gallon tank, our water pump will then pressurize it to go to our shower, and it'll be an on-demand water pump, which will pressurize it to the shower and the sink. And that's the only place will it be pressurized, from the sink to the tank to the sink and shower. When it leaves the drain, when it hits the drain from the sink and shower, it goes to the gray water storage tank. There will be it will not be under pressure at that point. It'll all be dealt with gravity flow. So the waste management department has said that that's all meets the approval and whatnot. So all we have to do is bring in the plans for that and show them the documentation on our toilet, and they will write us a letter to take over to the planning department, and we don't have to worry about any of that stuff. So that's all free and clear. The other thing we have, we plan on building. We've settled down on and decided to build a 14 by 20 cabin, floating style cabin, which does not mean it floats on water. I've had a couple of people, when I say floating cabin, they think we mean the kind of cabin like a houseboat. And this does not mean the kind of cabin that you build and floats on water.
Different kind of float.
What you mean by floating cabin is that it's a mobile cabin. The reason why you don't just say mobile cabin is because by saying mobile cabin, you mean a cabin built on wheels. A floating cabin is not built on wheels. A floating cabin is built on skids.
Think like those sheds you can get at the big hardware stores and house improvement stores, where they put them out in the parking lot and they're like, hey, we have this for sale. We'll deliver it.
So our 14 by 20 cabin will be built on skids. So you can basically go rent or hire a flatbed truck, and they can attach a winch to it, slide it up onto the flatbed truck, and drive it away at any point in time. That's why it's called floating, because it's not built onto a foundation. Here in Pennsylvania, or at least in the township that we're building in, anything over 100 square feet, which is a 10 by 10, requires a $10
permit.
Because ours is going to be 14 by 20, it requires a $17 building permit. But because there's no utilities hooked up to it, there's no plumbing hooked up to it, nothing will be hooked up to it from city or state utilities or power or water or anything like that. And internet does not count. So because we're not hooking anything up to it, then there's no inspections, there's no restrictions or anything. It's basically considered a shed, and we just need to pay $17 to build a 14 by 20 shed.
And they knew we're living in it.
And then they will come out and measure it to make sure that it's only 14 by 20. And we can live in it all we want.
Right.
They don't care about whether you live in it or not. All they care about is that it's 14 by 20 and not bigger. It could be smaller, it just can't be bigger. We will pay $17 to build the 14x20 cabin on it. And then we will be able to have our solar and wind turbine set up. They are checking to find out if the wind turbine will require a $10 permit or not, a one-time permit, because it requires a concrete anchor to hold the pole up. So they said that may need a $10 permit because they're using concrete.
Foundation.
Not a foundation, it's an anchor.
Right.
An anchor, because it has a concrete anchor, it may need a $10 permit, which is no big deal. That would only be $27 to build our cabin and put our wind turbine up. No problem.
And it's a one-time thing, too.
And it's a one-time thing. We never have to pay it again. We would have 6 months to build the cabin from time of purchase of the permit.
Oh, boy.
So far, it's all good. The property that we are buying is on the corner of the person's property that we're buying it from. And even though he's never had it surveyed before, the neighbor had it surveyed and had installed a gas well right on the corner of the property, or
very, very
close to the corner of the property that we are buying. Which means when they installed that gas well, they had to survey the corner of that property, which means there's a survey marker, or there has to be a survey marker, and it has to be marked out on the neighbor's deed. And because his land butts up against the land we're buying, the surveyor, when we go to have our property surveyed, they can look at the neighbor's survey map, find the marker, and survey out our 5 acres right off of the neighbor's marker. And that would only cost us for the subdivision would only cost us $30 plus whatever the surveyor charges to actually survey out the 5 acres.
There might be another $30 if the whole subdivision plan and blah 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 is submitted and approved. Then I think there's another $30 to have it recorded. Technicalities and semantics, but it's still not going to be crazy.
Basically, at most, it's only going to cost us $60 for the subdivision. $30 at the minimum, $60 at the maximum to have the subdivision recorded, and then whatever the surveyor costs or charges to have it actually surveyed. But because the neighbor has a gas well installed right there at that corner, that means the neighbor had to have had his land surveyed, and that means there has to be a survey marker there. So that's good. So we shouldn't have, as it stands right now, we shouldn't have a problem getting it surveyed, other than finding a surveyor who's willing to come out and do that. And we're going to call a bunch of surveyors right now. We have all their phone numbers. So we're going to start calling around right now as soon as we get out of the vehicle and get them and find out if they can. So from there, all we are waiting on now basically is getting somebody to come out and survey it. If the surveying goes good, then we just have the surveyor go out, they survey it, they do the whole, their little deal, give us the survey map, and they do a background check on the deed to the property. Then the property deed comes back with no problems on the background check, then we take all that stuff and we take it over to the planning department and they submit it. And they said within 24 hours, if there's no problems or any conflicts within 24 hours, we can sign the deal and have our property. So right now, as it stands, everything's good to go. There are no restrictions on the property that we're buying. According to the zoning department and everything, we can have as many goats, chickens, rabbits, the garden as big as we want. Our garden can be 5 acres large if we want it. There's no restrictions, no permits or anything required. We can have their garden as big as we want it. We can have as many goats as we want, as many chickens, as many ducks, whatever. Because it's in a farming community, we can have whatever we want because it's not a residential community. And then the only restriction is the fact that we need to pay $17 for the 14 by 20 cabin to be built because it's greater than 10 by 10. So
fence is fine as long as we don't put concrete on the posts. Otherwise, yeah, we have to go.
As long as we don't pour concrete, there are no permits required other than the cabin. So, alrighty, that's where we stand right now for our off-grid experience, and that's our update. And as soon as we get more information on what's going on, we will fill you in later. Thanks for watching FixedByDoc. Have a great day.